Hello, and welcome to the Overflow podcast. My name's Craig Booker.
The title of this episode is Old Tools.
The material in this episode is inspired by Scene by Will Hutcherson and Chinwé Williams.
Note, I will talk a lot about mental health, but please note this is not a substitute for therapy or mental health care.
The title of this episode is Old Tools.
We're starting a new study on the book Scene, Healing Despair and Anxiety in Kids and Teens Through the Power of Connection. In the book, Will opens with a story about one of what he calls his top students or his favorite students, Tyler. And he says, you know, he goes on saying you're not really supposed to have favorites, but he really enjoyed spending time with this student named Tyler. And so Tyler was a 17-year-old student who he described as funny, respectful, and smart. And it appeared as if Tyler had it all together. On the inside, Tyler was struggling with despair. Will says, he shared with me the struggle he had to get out of bed some mornings. Despite loving the program and the other students, Tyler had moments of self-doubt. In his worst moments, he even had thoughts of ending his life. In this book, it's sometimes a little confusing because it could be confusing because they switch between authors. There's two authors. There's Will Hutcherson, I believe is the name, and Chinwé Williams. And so they usually designate who's speaking. In this chapter, it looks like, for the most part, Will is speaking. He's talking about how this student, Will, has seemingly looks like he has everything together on the outside. He has lots of stuff going for him in his life, but yet he still shares, or this student Tyler shares with him that he has even had thoughts of ending his life. And so he's asking the question, how does a kid who seemingly has it all together get so down? And he says, he has so much going for him, right? He comes from a good family, check. He wasn't bullied as a kid, check. He didn't have any significant trauma from abuse, check. So what was happening is what he asks. And you know, this seeing this student that he really enjoyed spending time with, so much struggle, so much, even though he had so much going for him, really caused Will to start questioning and investigating. So Will was seeing similar things in many of his students. Students seemed to be increasingly disengaged or detached in recent years. Parents and students approached Will with concerns they had for others. They would say things like, they would say things like, they just don't seem like themselves anymore. They're always down. She is saying some things that are really concerning me. So, you know, all these people, students, parents coming to him, expressing concern for other people that they see in their lives that are struggling with despair. He goes on, he says, more and more students were feeling paralyzed and anxious when facing resistance or obstacles in life. Students were losing their resilience and their motivation. Many of Will's students were self-diagnosing as being depressed or very depressed, while others were describing panic attacks or anxiety. Even worse, others were describing their past attempts at suicide, while others detailed their future plans. As Will did more investigation, he found that this was happening nationwide. In this part of the chapter, they're kind of setting up the whole book. So they're giving a lot of background information. They're setting the scene for why this is so important. And so the next part, they go into some statistics to try to help give a better picture of what's going on. And they say since 2007, suicide rates have increased by 76% for ages 15 to 19. Suicide rates nearly doubled in teen girls. The highest rate of increase in suicide among all age groups is in kids between 10 and 14 years old. All right, so he goes on with some more statistics. He says depressive symptoms are up 21% in boys and up 50% in girls. Suicide attempts among black teens increased by 73% between 1991 and 2017. And there is an elevated risk of suicide among African-American boys aged 5 to 11. In early 2020, an estimated 1 out of 4 young adults contemplated suicide. In March of 2020, the Disaster Distress Helpline saw an increase of 891% in call volume. So the book is laying the foundation, all these statistics about changes in brain health and mental health that they're seeing, that kids are just having a really tough time with despair. And so, you know, some of these are very hard to wrap your mind around. Just that last one of the Disaster Distress Helpline increasing their call volume by 891% just blows my mind. And so, you know, it just paints the picture of how serious this really is for our society and for youth. And the next section is titled A Time When I Blew It. Will returns to the story about Tyler here, and he says that he believed in Tyler so much he thought maybe he just needed a push. So Will worked with another program leader to come up with a plan, maybe thinking that he just needed some extra encouragement, maybe he just needed to see his own potential. He came up with this plan. He says, together they executed the plan, believing they would have a new student in 90 days. So he's telling the story here. He says, during a church retreat, Tyler experienced a setback. Tyler being the student, he says, the combination of being away from family and in a spiritually charged environment caused his anxiety to increase. When Tyler tried to share his feelings with a leader, they were dismissed. Instead of acknowledging his feelings, he was met with statements like, just trust God and keep praying. On the second night, feeling uncomfortable and alone, Tyler called his parents. They drove 2 hours to pick him up without telling any of the staff. Shocked, the leaders said, well, we are going to have a hard talk about this. And these, or it says, the hard talks they insisted on backfired. Tyler became resistant, disrespectful, and seemed angry. A few months into their plan, Tyler blindsided them by telling them he wouldn't be attending the upcoming retreat. Will was furious with Tyler, and he called him into his office. And when Tyler tried to tell Will how he was feeling, his feelings weren't heard. Will was too busy caught up in what he was going to say. Will was too caught up in what he was going to say. Will lectured Tyler on the commitment he had made to the program. Again, Tyler tried to tell Will his feelings. Will told Tyler, I understand that you feel that way, but it doesn't matter. You need to get over how you're feeling and come with us. Next day, Tyler quit the program. And so just in complete shock about Tyler's response, Will explains that he wasn't able to help Tyler because he was using what he calls old tools. And these are methods that might still work with some, but they wouldn't work for most kids. All right, so he goes on and he's talking about, he titles a section, The Good News. And he says, our greatest weapon against despair and suicide is you, parents, small group leaders, youth pastors, caring adults. And he continues, there are tools that can help kids and teenagers heal. Our brains are designed to respond in predictable ways when we connect with others on a deep level and when we feel seen. In fact, research shows that we aren't powerless at all. For instance, research on the neuroscience of attachment shows us that the brain can learn a new attachment pattern because of the process of neuroplasticity. The brain has the ability to rewire and reorganize itself. Will goes on to say, another helpful discovery is that a secure attachment with an adult can not only help heal and rewire the brain from a past insecure attachment, but it can also help decrease the risk for despair and suicidal thoughts in adolescence. So this idea that the brain can heal itself, it's not just automatic, but there is the possibility that, you know, your brain can be changed, this idea of neuroplasticity. And so whether you're a parent of a preschooler, elementary age kid, teenager, or young adult, you can begin habits now that will nurture emotionally healthy development and create resilience against despair when they're older. There are practical things that you can do right now to intervene and begin the process of healing. These are tools that will help you make significant connections that lead to change. Tools I wish I had with Tyler. He said, I did many things wrong in my plan to help Tyler, but the greatest was my inability to see him and what he was feeling. He didn't feel seen. Ironically, if I had just connected and resisted the urge to fix him, I could have played a part in helping him to heal. Instead, I unknowingly played a part in keeping him right where he was. And Will goes on to say, I'm happy to report that Tyler is doing great today. He went to counseling and is managing his depression. He describes the true key to Tyler's success was his parents. They were deeply engaged. They prayed for him every day, and they instinctively used many of the tools we will share in this book. These strategies are ground tested, and we believe they will empower you to be part of the solution to the rising despair we are seeing in kids and teenagers. They will help you connect with, give hope to, and lead the next generation towards healing. All right, so again, he's painting this picture of the importance of kids feeling seen and heard. We created some discussion questions for this section or chapter of the book. How does it feel to know that when we feel seen, our brains are wired to respond in predictable ways? That's number one. Number two is we learn that the brain has the ability to rewire and reorganize itself. How does this impact how you see anxiety, depression, or despair?
That's all for this episode. Thank you for watching. If you liked the video, give us a thumbs up and be sure to subscribe so you don't miss out on future episodes.